Hi guys, today we are going to cover MCQs for April 2019 from Yojana and Kurukshetra. So Yojana and Kurukshetra, both these magazines hold a lot of importance when we're talking about NABARD examination. Although they are not so important for RBI or SEBI, but for NABARD, they hold a lot of importance. And that is why I have started creating Yojana and Kurukshetra backwards from April 2019, which is the most recent month. And in order to help you prepare yourself for the upcoming examination, I'll be discussing certain questions which I have created along with the PDF of Yojana and Kurukshetra for the month of April 2019. So without wasting any time, let's start with the MCQs. As you can see here, the first question is, at present, what is India's share in global textile industry? So the question clearly asks as a percentage of the global textile industry, which is, let's say, 100%, how much does India contribute to manufacturing or to exports or to entire share or entire production in the global textile industry? Well, this is a purely factual question, and such factual questions have been asked in the examination in the past. So let me take you through some of the facts which are important from examination point of view, and then we will move forward and discuss the answer. If you already know the answer, please type it in the comment section below so that I have an idea as to how many of you are preparing seriously for the examination and how well prepared are you for the upcoming exam. So let's go towards the discussion on India's share in global textile industry as well as certain other important facts. As you can see here, there are a lot of facts available here. This is the PDF on Yojana and Kurukshetra for April 2019. The first fact which is important, which I wanted to discuss, is related to the question itself. India's share of 3.1% in the global garment industry or the textile industry, whereas China's share in the global, as a percentage of global textile industry, is a whopping 35%, which is amazingly high. India, on the other hand, should have been at this point of time, should have been at somewhere around 30 to 35%, because of the problems with our policies and the implementation of our policies, we have lagged behind at only 3.1%. While Bangladesh has 60% more share than India, it does not mean that Bangladesh has a 60% share in the overall garment industry, global garment industry. It only says that 60% more share than India, which is also a good feat for Bangladesh, given how less developed it is compared to India. Now, this was one fact which I wanted you to remember and which I wanted to discuss. Certain other facts which are important: the textile industry comprises of three sectors. You have to remember this: power loom, mills, and hand looms. Now, you must be wondering, the first question that any smart person would have in his mind is that, what is the difference between power loom, mills, and hand looms? Well, mills is the first level, and mills is a superset which might also include power loom sector. Textile mills create threads out of cotton or out of any other substance which is used to create threads. Okay, whereas looming is the process of converting threads into cloth. So what I'm wearing right now, cloth, is made in the power loom industry or the hand loom industry, whereas the mills indulge or involve in the activity of converting the raw material into threads. So that is the main difference. Now, you can see here in these facts very clearly, power looms contribute 61%, approximately 61%, to the overall or entire textile industry in India, which is actually very sad for a country like India, because hand looms has been our traditional strength. Before the British came into India, Indian hand looms were popular around the world, and that is why we should have been moving back towards hand loom sector, towards encouraging the hand loom sector, but the same has not been happening. Why? The government's policies again. Okay, so this was another set of facts which I wanted to discuss with you. Mills is only 3.34%. Exports. Total exports, although you can just go through it, about $40 billion in the year 2018, not very important. These three facts hold a lot of importance. 7% of the total industry output in value terms comes from textile sector. Number two, 2% of India's GDP is contributed by the textile industry, and it employs about 45 million people in the year 2017-18. This is the employment data. And 15% of our export earnings in this financial year 17-18 have come from the textile industry. These three facts hold a lot of importance. Questions can be framed directly or indirectly from these facts. Let's come back to the question now. So the question was, at present, what is India's share in global textile industry? I am sure you must have guessed the answer by now. It is 3%. Let's come to the second question. At present, what is contribution of textile industry to GDP of India? We are talking about the contribution of textile to GDP of India. We just discussed it. It is a mere 2%. Okay, I hope you have understood all these facts. What is the contribution of textile industry to export earnings of India in 2017-18? Out of total exports of India, what percentage has textile industry contributed? The answer we just discussed is 15% for this particular question. I am very sure, and I hope you have, you are able to recall and remember all these facts. Not very difficult. Which of the following cannot be an advantage of a healthy textile industry in India? Now, this is an analytical question. The first three questions that I took were purely factual. Now, let's move on to an analytical question and see how well are you able to perform. The question is, which of the following cannot be an advantage of a healthy textile industry in India? So, what you can do in order to make it easier for yourself to answer the question is that you can convert this question into, which of the following can be an advantage of a healthy textile industry, and then you can eliminate. A healthy textile industry can create rural employment at a large scale. Now, any healthy industry, let it be textile, let it be any other industry, if it does not generate employment, then it is of no use, and therefore this has to be an advantage. Very layman, very logical. You don't need to read on textile industry or any other industry in order to eliminate such options. Stop the declining labor force participation rate, especially among women. Now, you must have heard, even if you have not gone through the textile PDF that I've created, is that the handloom and textile industry in India has traditionally been handled by women, because women have traditionally been involved in weaving at home or in involving in certain financial activity at home, while the men would go out into the fields. That is how textile became an important activity where participation of women was very high, and it has remained very high over the years. But due to certain reasons, the labor force participation rate among women especially has gone down, but it can be improved further if the handloom industry and the overall handmade textile industry can be promoted. Therefore, stopping the declining labor force participation rate, especially among women, is or can be an advantage. Encourage and promote agriculture due to strong linkages between agriculture and textile industry. The best example here is cotton. Cotton is the raw material produced or manufactured or created, planted by the agriculture sector, which is provided as a raw material to the textile mills. Therefore, this is also correct, or this is also an advantage of a healthy textile industry. Reverse our reliance on urban clusters for employment generation. This is again a very logical statement, because textile industry has been traditionally performed by the rural areas, and therefore if we want to reduce or ignore or try and reduce the dependency of people on urban clusters for employment, we have to encourage employment in areas like textiles, which are traditionally being performed by the rural areas. And this is also being recommended by late APJ Abdul Kalam, who talked about development in the rural sectors, and that is what this also talks about. Compete China in low value but high volume handmade textiles. Now, why this particular statement is incorrect, or is fundamentally incorrect, to be using the right word, is because it says low value but high volume handmade textiles. While handmade textiles have always been low volume but high value. Why low volume? Because they have to be made from hands. Why high value? Because they are made from hands, and they're unique every set of product that is being created. Let's say you buy a bag which is handmade. Every bag will have a different design. Even if it has the same design, there will be variations in the design because it has been made by hand. And therefore, it is of high value because it is unique to your requirements. Every bag is different. Okay. But at the same time, it is of low volume because it takes a lot of time to weave anything by hand compared to using machines. And therefore, our answer is E, which says that which of the following cannot be an advantage. Well, this is not an advantage of the textile industry. Well, here is the answer. Let's come to the third question. We'll be talking about a lot of acronyms, let me remind you, in this particular lesson and also in the upcoming lessons. And we will also be talking about areas connected with these questions, which might not be a part of Yojana in Kurukshetra. One such example is this particular question. The question says, which of the following statement is incorrect about FDI rules for textile industry in India? Well, I have already provided a detailed list of latest FDI rules with respect to the percentage allowed in FDI in various sectors. And it has been provided in the finance notes, finance theory notes. So you can go through them. Whereas this particular question talks about only the textile industry. The options are 100% FDI under automatic route is allowed in textile industry, 100% FDI with 49% under automatic route, and the remaining under approval route is allowed in textile industry. I want you to tell me the difference between automatic and approval route. Type it in the comment section below right now. You can just pause it and type it, so that you can have a self-check as to how much do you know or remember about it. And I also want you to write down about how approval happens in the approval route, because recently some changes have been made in the process of approval route, and some organizations or bodies have been abolished related to approval route. So a question can also be framed there. 51% FDI under approval route is allowed in textile industry. 49% FDI under automatic route is allowed in textile industry. The answer to this question is A, 100% FDI under automatic route is allowed in textile industry. Let's talk about approval process, which was followed before the change, and approval process, which is followed now. Well, before FIPB, Foreign Investment Promotion Board, under Department of Economic Affairs, used to approve the proposals of FDI in certain sectors, and the approval used to be, or the recommendation used to be, provided to Finance Minister or Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs. But now FIPB has been abolished, this has been abolished, and individual departments have been created, or individual departments related to different ministries, wherever the approval process or the approval file goes. Let's say this is for textile industry, it will go to the related ministry, and the individual department in that ministry which is looking after FDI proposals will, along with DPIIT, it used to be DIPP, Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, it has now been changed to DPIIT under of Ministry of Commerce and Industry, both these bodies together process the approval now, and they either reject it or they either allow it. Okay. So this is the process which I wanted to discuss with you. Another factual question, National Handloom Day is observed every year on. A factual question which might be asked in the examination. The answer is B, 7th August. Next question, which of the following correctly explains community tourism? Community tourism. An analytical question again. You need to understand different types of tourism, community tourism being one of them. I will be discussing what is ethno-tourism and what is food route or food tourism. Okay. What are the options? Let's have a look at the options. Please provide the answers in the comment section before I answer them, so that I know how engaged are you and how much you know already. The options are to view different cultures, various ethnic and cultural lifestyles and beliefs, a responsible travel to natural areas that conserves the environment and improves the well-being of local people. This tourism is all about foods of different communities and knowing more about different staples or different communities. To view different employment styles based on community, explore Amul-like initiatives. So all these are connected with community, and therefore you might get confused as to what is the exact meaning of community tourism? Let's have a look at the answer. The answer is a responsible travel to natural areas that conserves the environment and improves well-being of local people. So community tourism is not about exploring a community. Community tourism is about traveling to natural areas where local communities or where traditional communities have been living for a long time, and to help them in conserving the environment and improve the well-being of local people, to understand how they behave, to understand how they carry out their activities, day-to-day activities, and how do they contribute in conserving the environment or in their own well-being. Well, the other options: to view different cultures, various ethnic and cultural lifestyles and beliefs. This is ethno-tourism. This is the same that I've written here. The number one is ethno-tourism. Two here is this one, the third one. So let me write three here. This is food routes or food tourism. And the fourth one I have created on my own. There is no such tourism, which is specifically focused on exploring Amul-like community initiatives. Okay, let's go to the next question. Which of the following is not one of four A's promoted for a more responsible and attractive tourism in India? There are four A's and there are seven S's or sutras which the government have recently provided to promote tourism in the country. The options are accessibility, accommodation, attraction, amenities, and abundance. Please answer the question in the comment section below, and I will explain to you how to remember all the four A's as well as seven S's in a very short while. So let's have your answers below, and I'm moving to the answer now. The answer is last option, abundance. Now, how do you remember? Because you must be thinking, how do I remember all these facts and all these things which are very difficult to remember and recall? Let's say you're taking a road trip from Mumbai to Lonavala. What will you do? First of all, the first one is taking of the road trip, going for the road trip. So that is accessibility. Let's keep it at or synonymize it with the accessibility of roads. So that helps you remember that accessibility is the first one. After you have taken the road trip from Mumbai to Lonavala, you have arrived in Lonavala, you will be taking a resort in Lonavala. When you take a resort there, that means accommodation. So this is the second one, accommodation. After you have arrived at the destination, you would probably want to freshen up. So you need water in the toilet, right? That is what? That is availability of amenities, basic amenities, whether it's food, whether it's water, all those things. And the last, when you have gone to a destination, you would certainly want to go out for sightseeing. That is what? That is attractions. So there is no name or no relation of abundance with four A's of tourism. Okay, I hope you can remember it now. Let's come to the last question, and in fact the one of the most important questions for today. Which of the following is not one of seven sutras for tourism in India? Swagat, Swachhata, Suchna, Suvidha, Sampradayikta. If you don't know Hindi, it's very difficult for you to either remember it or recall it or even answer it, because one of the options is very extreme in this particular question. If you know Hindi, then probably you can answer it. The answer is Sampradayikta, which is communalism. Okay. Let me take you to the shortcut through which you can remember all these seven S's. This is the shortcut which I have created for learning seven S's. These are, remember, in English, because there are a lot of students who don't know Hindi, and you can convert all these English terms into Hindi later on. The shortcut is, or the acronym is, C cube I square SW. So for seven S's, you have C cube I square SW. This is how you can remember it. What is C cube? C cube is comfort, cleanliness, cooperation. I square is information, infrastructure. S is security, and W is welcome. Now, when you convert all these English terms into Hindi, you arrive at the following. Comfort is Suvidha. Cleanliness is Swachhata, Swachhata Bharat Abhiyan, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Cooperation is Sahyog. Information is Suchna. Infrastructure is Samrachna. Security is Suraksha. And welcome is Swagat. So all these are seven S's, and above, these are the English term of those seven S's. Even if you don't remember all the seven S's, remembering the English terms and connecting them with the Hindi terms might help you in recalling all of them. Remember, this is the shortcut or the acronym CQ I2 SW. So this was all for today's questions on Yojana and Kurukshetra for April 2019. I will also be taking questions on Yojana and Kurukshetra for March 2019 very soon. Till then, all the best. Take care.